It is a joy to gather together as a body of Christ to worship our Lord together. If you're able, I'd like to invite you to please stand for the call to worship. How good it is to sing praises to our God. How pleasant and fitting to praise Him. Great is our Lord and mighty in power. His understanding has no limit. The Lord sustains the humble, but cast out the wicked to the ground.
Sing to the Lord with grateful praise. Make music for our God on our
heart. Let us worship our Lord with a song of praise.
And grace.
Let us pray. Lord Jesus, you are the light of the world. We thank you, Lord, that you give us your light. You point to the love and the grace that you have for us. You tell us to come and follow you. So, Lord, we have gathered this day to follow you, to boldly approach you, Lord, and to expect grace from you. We thank you, Lord, for your love for us. You indeed, Lord, give us joy and hope and peace. We thank you, Lord, that you are sovereign, King of kings and Lord of lords. So, Lord, we gather this day and we affirm what you have taught your apostles, saying, I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sitteth on the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Lord, we thank you that we may come boldly to you and know that you love us, that you are good, that you are indeed our good shepherd. Lord, we come humbly before you because we confess that indeed we rebel against you. We sin, Lord. So hear us now, Lord, as we confess silently our prayers, our sins to you. Lord, we thank you that when we confess our sins, Scriptures tells us that you forgive us of our sins and all unrighteousness, that everyone who calls on the name of the Lord shall be saved. It is through you alone, Lord, we do have forgiveness. Thank you, Lord, for the gift of prayer that we may share with you and speak to you and hear from you and know with confidence that you love us and that you hear us. So, Lord, we pray this prayer in your holy name, Jesus. Amen. It is through Jesus Christ that we do have peace, that we do have forgiveness. Let us share the peace of Christ with one another. Please greet the ones next to you with the peace of Christ. It's a privilege for me to share what's going on in the life of our church. You may find some of the important things going on in the life of the church on page 6 in your bulletin. Some things I would like to highlight. First of all, confirmation class is coming up soon. That is for 8th graders and older. 7th graders are welcome with a conversation with me. We might let you squeak into the class, but confirmation class, that will start January 22nd, and parents are invited to that as well as the students who are taking that. Also, Kingdom Festival returns to TGC. This is for children of 3 years to 5th grade. This event will take place from 9:30 in the morning to 11:30 in the morning on Saturday, January 28th in the Family Life Center. Also, please note that we have a congregational meeting this day at 5 o'clock. We will gather together to hear the updates of the church, to hear reports of the church. to hear and receive and vote on deacons and elders, as well as the pastor's calls. So that's 5 o'clock today. Hopefully you've registered. If not, you are welcome for our dinner today. At this time, it's my joy for special music with Letta and David.
Thank you. child, kid, son, daughter, come on up. Love to talk with you for a moment. Good morning. Good to see you. Hi, how are you? Good to see you today. You got a new dress? Wow, I love it. It's beautiful. Thank you. Hey, Wells, it's good to see you. You know, wasn't that just an amazing piece of music to make that little piece of metal do that in that wood and ivory do that and the metal that's clanging inside? It's just amazing. And I was thinking about how much music we have in our times when we get together to worship and singing and all that. And it actually made me think of like music and singing everywhere else, the other stuff, other places we do it. Because this past week was Tabitha's birthday. And guess what? We sang a song to her. Anyone know what song we sang to her? How's it go? Happy birthday. Yeah. You got it. Yeah, because you probably do that too. Whenever there's a birthday, oh my goodness, you sing a song. And my daughter Amanda was visiting with us, and I looked up, and there was a picture of when she got married. And you know what happened? As soon as she got married, we all went to this place, and there was just music. You know, we call it a wedding reception. Just music playing, and we're dancing and singing right after she got married to Ryan. And then I was also thinking, just a few days ago, it was New Year's Eve, and most of you probably have never stayed all the way up to midnight. But if you did, you end up usually turning the TV on, and almost every station when New Year's happens has what? Music, songs, bands together, people dancing and singing. And I was thinking, what an amazing gift music is, because it seems like every time we want to celebrate and say, ah, something good has happened, guess what we do? We sing. We sing. We dance. We celebrate with music. In some way, we're going to talk about this in big church in a little bit, in some way, God has given this amazing gift of song and celebrate, song and music, instrumentation, in order to go, yes, ah, yes, celebrate. And that's why we have so much music in our worship services. That's why Letta and David did just what they did. That's why we're singing songs at the beginning and end of it, because we want to celebrate. So I hope as you sing, and as actually everyone else here sings, you always remember we're not just doing words, we're not just going through stuff. We are actually in our hearts celebrating what God has done among us. Now, when you go out to kids' church, if you go there, I hope you sing a song. If you stay in here, I know you're going to sing a song, but let's pray right now that we have a reason to celebrate. Lord, we do rejoice and find joy in you and gladness because we have a reason to celebrate what you have done in our lives. And Lord, we pray that you'd use all of who we are, our bodies, our minds, our heart, that may all come together in song to worship and to give you praise, we ask in Jesus' name. Amen. All right, you guys head on back to Mom and Dad or out to Kids Church, and I think we have another wonderful piece of celebration led by our music team. We are stepping away from our series in Ephesians this week, and we'll return to it next week. But in celebration, recognition of Letta's last week with us, leading us as our director of music, it just felt eminently appropriate to remind ourselves, as we just did, about the importance of music and of worship and of song. Do be in prayer for our music team during the upcoming transition. Without Letta's leadership, it will take all hands on deck to continue to lead and weave together a worship service that impacts our love for Christ, helps us to express ourselves in greater way, and we're going to dearly miss Letta among us. We, after the service in the fellowship hall across the way, we'll have a time of celebration, recognition of Letta. I hope you'll stop in, join us for that time. And it's a marvelous day of celebration for us towards that end. If I've learned anything over the years about Letta, is that her primary language of love is gift giving. Laura and I and Tabitha have received numerous gifts of decorations and candy, raspberry chocolate candies and Ricolas, just, you know, when I was not feeling well, a gift that way. And probably my favorite was she gave us a dessert made of ube, which is a shockingly purple yam, a dessert made out of it that I've never tasted anything like it in my life and had seen anything so bright and purple as that. Well, for a number of years now, Letta has been sharing with us her gifts, her gift of leadership, her gifts in music. Why? Because she loves you and because she loves the Lord. And so we want to spend today thinking about such love and thinking about worship and song and praise as a gift. And to do so, we'll read from Psalm 149 this day. Here's what the psalmist writes. He says, "Praise the Lord. Sing to the Lord a new song, his praise in the assembly of the faithful. Let Israel be glad in his maker. Let the sons of Zion rejoice in their king. Let them praise his name with dancing, make melody to him with timbrel and lyre. For the Lord takes pleasure in his people. He adorns the humble with victory. Let the faithful exult in glory. Let them sing for joy on their couches or bed. Let the high praises of God be in their throats and two-edged swords in their hands to wreak vengeance on the nations and chastisement on the peoples, to bind their kings with chains and their nobles with fetters of iron, to execute on them the judgment written. This is glory for all his faithful ones. Praise the Lord." This is the word of God. Let's pray. Lord, we do thank you for your word. We thank you for the gift of music, the gift of song and psalms and spiritual songs and hymns. And we ask, as we think about this great gift this day, you would work a miracle in our heart to help us to understand, not only with our minds, but with our bodies and with our psyche and heart, your goodness, your grace. And Lord, help us to amplify all of that to your glory, we pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Back in the 1990s, Matt Redman attended a church called Soul Survivor Church in Watford, England. He was the worship leader. It was a very vibrant church. It was filled with young people, college students, teenagers, along with an intergenerational presence as well. He was an amazing, gifted worship leader and brought the whole package to the church in terms of leadership and music. His senior pastor one day at a staff meeting said, you know, I've been thinking, his name was Mike Pivlarchi, and he said, you know, I just think for a season, we should go during our Sunday worship gatherings without music, the music setup, the band, and all that. He said, you know, we love to sing, but I think we should refocus a bit and make sure we're not leaning too much on all the props and all the systems, the sound systems, and all that, just to make sure we can still bring an offering to God. So let's just gather with our voices and sing. And let's just have scripture and worship just for a little while. And the staff kind of looked at each other like, is he serious? And he was. And so they did. And Matt wasn't really sure what he was going to do with himself. I mean, he was the music director. This is what he was supposed to do, put this all together in this way. And there he was, now just leading with his voice in everyone else's voice. He said the first week just felt so awkward. But then he said it became the most transformative experience in his life. It made him check his motives, why he was doing what he was doing. Did he actually have something to offer to God that was meaningful? Or was this all just for his own enjoyment and sort of pride in what he could bring about and produce? Was it all for his own pleasure? And so after this season was done, he wrote a song. It's a song we'll sing in a moment. It's called The Heart of Worship. And the words, you'll see them, you can look at them in the bulletin yourself if you want. The words start out, you know, when the music fades and all is stripped away, and I simply come longing just to bring something that's of worth, that will bless your heart, Lord. I'll bring you more than a song, for a song in itself is not what you have required. You search more deeper within through the ways things appear. You're looking into my heart. I'm coming back to the heart of worship. It's all about you. It's all about you, Jesus, he wrote. I'm sorry, Lord, for the things that I've made it to be, when it's all about you. It's all about you, Jesus. Let me ask you, what have you made worship to be? Is it all about you? Or is it all about him? Because you remember how Paul starts out his letter to the Ephesians. We spent 3 weeks studying it. He starts out, praise be to God the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who has blessed us with all the spiritual blessings in the heavenly realms. He goes on for 14 verses to speak of what God the Father had done in Christ, using the term in Christ, 11 times. Because why? Because it's all about him. I shared with you like probably a year ago or so a story about a time at my home church in Boston, where I'd spent a number of years before we came down here. And it was after the service, and we had a prayer time, much like we do here, and a woman came up to me. I had no idea who she was. I never saw her before, expecting her to come up to pray, have something upon her heart to pray about. And she just laced into the sermon, complaining about how bad the sermon was. And I was so thankful because I wasn't the preacher that day. And she just went on and on from the sermon to other parts of the service, complaining about this and that, how it wasn't good. And, you know, I'm there keeping a smile on my face, you know. But inside, I was just getting angrier and angrier at this woman, thinking, who do you think you are, lady, to come into our church and start, you know, tearing us apart? I thought it was a pretty good service as a whole. And so I'm thinking, now, how am I going to confront this woman? And as she finally wrapped up, I looked her in the eyes and said, let's pray. And I didn't say anything to her. I just prayed. Prayed that God would be glorified in everything we do, even if it isn't our very best. And I went on and on. I didn't confront her because the more she talked, the more I saw myself in her. Every time I come home, I make worship all about me. I'm judging it. How was the sermon? Did it do anything for me? How was the music? Oh, it wasn't that. Look, remember when that happened? Oh, that was, I wish it didn't go that way. It's just, I'm so critical. And I put myself in the center and judge. It's all about you, Chris. It's all about the way you see it. And, oh, you know it's not. It's all about him. It's all about, that's why Paul starts off that letter to the Ephesians. It's all about the plan of the Father. It's all about the work of the Son. It's all about his work as it's applied and actuated through the presence of the Holy Spirit. It's all to his glory. When it's all stripped away, it's all about Jesus. It's all about you, Lord. But though it's all about him, nevertheless, it does involve us. It is, worship's an act that we do. It's a posture in which we place ourselves. And the psalm says that God takes pleasure in his people as they worship. He's made us to be creatures of worship. We're going to worship something. It's either going to be the Lord or it's going to be something else, because you've been made that way, to have an object in which to revel in, to rejoice in, to say, that's the most important thing in my life. We're all going to worship. God's made us that way. The chief end of man is to worship God, we're reminded by the reformers. And so as we look at our psalm today, we find out that, well, it helps us to understand the shape of worship. It explains to us the nature of it, how we are to worship, when we are to worship in this. And we could have picked any of the psalms at the end of the book. The entire book crescendos in this great declaration of worship, one after the other, is the book of Psalms, is the songbook of Scripture that captures the end time realities that will have already begun and will be consummated one day as we sing to him. But What do we find out when we look at this psalm, Psalm 149? Well, first, we find out that worship is an act of cognition. It is something that's intellectual. It's something of the mind that we assent to when we recognize who God is. It's something that's up here. The verse 2, it says, "Let Israel be glad in his maker," the psalmist says. He says that Israel is made by God. That God is the creator, the maker. Our entire dependence upon life, our life is contingent on the fact that he made us. If he didn't make us, we would not be here. And everything around us, the creation we enjoy, the air we breathe, the trees we see, the homes that are built out of the materials that are a part of his creation, it's all because he did it. And that's an intellectual step that we take to go, he made us. But when the psalmist talks about Israel specifically, he's not talking just about general creation. He's talking about that God took the least of the people, Israel, who had no reason to be chosen at all, and he made them his son. He's the maker in that way, that he's given this people a great privilege to experience his provision and protection. Unlike all the other nations around, his presence would be with them. That's why the second parallel statement in verse 2 says that, "Let Israel be glad in his maker." The second part says, "Let the children rejoice in their king." Maker and king are parallel, because it emphasizes his sovereignty to care for, to provide, to choose and to protect and provide for his people as a king, uniquely a people that no one else experienced in the same way. And all of this was supposed to be recognized in the mind, to understand that truth. And so worship followed. You cannot worship God unless you understand who he is in your life. There's no reason to gather and to express anything to him at all of that you owe him, that you depend upon him, that you're glad in him, unless you really take to, in the mind, understand what he has done for you and for us. But worship, it's not just an intellectual exercise or an acknowledgement of the mind. It involves the body. It's an action. Listen to what the psalmist says. Let the high praise of God be in their throats in verse 6. And he says, "Let them praise his name with dancing." In verse 3, make melody with tambourine and lyre. How do you do tambourine and lyres? Fingers and you know, all you've got to use your body to worship the Lord. It's an action, hands and feet and throat and mouth. Psalm 63:4 says, "I will praise you as long as I live, and in your name I will lift up my hands." You know, this action. Or you read in Revelation about the elders who lay down prostrate on the ground, and they take their crowns off and lay them down before the Lord. It's all physical. What's that all mean? That's all surrender, right? Surrender, right? Or if you lay on the ground, it's like, you know, you can come and do whatever you want to me. Step on me, trample me, whatever you want. It's all surrender. And it's all shown physically. And so this action and body, it can be expanded not just to symbolic things like that, but in actuality. The reformers believed that, you know, the Reformation kind of view, that work, the work you do is worship. That all of your body, your actions, the things you do with your hands, the things you create, give glory to God. So Paul says, whatever you do in word or deed, do it all in the name of the Lord Jesus, giving thanks to God the Father through him. Your actions are a way you give thanks to God. They're a worship. It's something of the mind. It's something of the body. But it's also, it's something of the heart. Psalmist states that worship is birthed from the heart. It involves emotion. Verse 2 again says, let Israel be glad in his maker. Let the children of Zion rejoice. Be glad and rejoice. Worship flows from our psyche, from our heart. It's the interior affection for God. It's a movement of the heart. Jesus quotes Isaiah in Matthew 15. He admonishes the Pharisees, these people honor me with their lips. They're using their body for sure. But their hearts are far from me. And Jesus says, they worship me in vain. They worship me in vain. If worship does not well up from the heart, from the emotion, this isn't my words, this is Jesus' words. It's in vain. You might as well not even be doing it if it doesn't involve the heart. True worship is a surrendering to God all glory and laud and honor by acknowledging, recognizing him with your mind, by showing it with your body. Body and mind should never be pulled apart, never put asunder. The body reflects the mind, but ultimately worship is an act of the heart. An act of love, an act of affection, act of emotion. God wants it all when you worship him. He wants all of your body. He wants all of your mind. He wants all of your heart, all of your emotion. As they're all being taken captive by the immeasurable beauty and grace and goodness and kindness that he's manifested to us. And that's why singing is so important. That's why singing is the most ingenious creation God has ever given us, because no other medium is given to us in which we can intertwine so uniquely our intellect, our body, and our heartfelt emotion. I mean, anybody who studies music, Aletta has, you know, a bunch of degrees she's working on, completing, into a doctorate. She's still studying music because there's so much to know about notation, harmony, patterns, tones, and then on top of that, the lyric, the poetry, the truth that it can be married to all of those sounds. It is an amazing intellectual gift given to us that presents truth so powerfully and succinctly. But music, it's of the body too. You cannot make music unless you use your body, your voice, or your hands, or your breath. Some way you've got to use your body to make music. And And of course, the more bodies that you have, the greater and more profound the declaration of praise is involved. It's a body, it's an incorporation of truth corporately in a body. And you know, there's no greater way to express emotion than through music. I had looked at a number of scientific studies getting ready for this, and I could have cited a whole bunch. One I came across, 2017, University of Melbourne, Australia, University of Hamburg, and a couple others. They worked together doing neuroimaging of the brain in the area where where emotion is processed. They've kind of identified, this is the motion part, where it is, I don't know. But somewhere in there, there's a spot that is related to emotion. And so they put music on of this kind, music on of that kind, fast, slow, sad, joyful, grand. And every time they change the music, the neuroimaging, the asymmetry, whatever they called it, changed. It was a profound change when different kinds of music was processed at that spot in the brain. Why? Because music, there's no greater way to express emotion, impact emotion, create and involve emotion than through music. Leo Tolstoy, the Russian novelist who wrote War and Peace, a great intellect, what he said was that music is the shorthand of emotion. Emotions which let themselves be described in words with such difficulty are directly conveyed to people in music. And that is the power and significance of it. And we don't need Tolstoy, we don't need scientists to tell us this. When David and Letta just played, the emotion welled in our souls. When I was in high school, I played basketball. Before every single game, I would listen to Foreigner's song, Hot Blooded, before I played. And I'd listen to Kool and the Gang's song, Jump Down On It, except I would change the words to Jump and Rebound It as I sang them. Because it emotionally got me ready for what was about to unfold. Music does that, whether for that or for sadness or whatever. Tolstoy was right, it's the shorthand of emotion, but it's also the shorthand of intellect. It's the shorthand of the body. It's combining all these three things, mind, body, heart, emotion, soul, psyche, spirit. This is why we sing at the very core of worship. It's all of this together, and we're joining with the heavenly chorus above itself. When we sing to God in the way that the psalmist exhorts, we are giving everything to God. That's why we sing. The psalmist also tells us when we are supposed to sing. He says, let the faithful people rejoice in this honor and sing for joy on their beds. We're supposed to sing on our beds when we wake up, when we lay down. And he goes on, may the praise of God be in their mouths and a double-edged sword in their hands to inflict vengeance on the nations and punishment on the peoples to bind them together. In other words, worship God when you rest at night. Worship God in the middle of battle. Worship God when you work. Our posture, our hearts, our actions and bodies at all times, we are to worship the Lord. But I think in these last verses, The psalmist is acknowledging more than just a general sense of worshiping God all the time, in all settings. But he's purposely raising this language of battle, of end time judgment, in this particular context. And if you go, it just parallels what he said at the beginning. It says, look, praise the Lord, sing to the Lord a new song, his praise in the assembly of the godly. Why a new song? What's the new song idea? Well, when do you sing a new song? When something really good happens. You know, singing is almost like a yeah! You know, like yes! Except it's far more beautiful than that. When Moses and Israel go through the Red Sea, and the Red Sea comes down on them, on the Egyptians, and judges the Egyptians, Israel makes it through. What do? They sing a song they've never sung before. Praise God, the horse and riders are in the sea. Why? Because it's victory. They're celebrating what God has done. And we find in Revelation 14, and I heard a voice from heaven like the roar of many waters and like the sound of loud thunder. The voice I heard was like the sound of harpists playing on their harps, and they were singing a new song before the throne, before the four living creatures and the elders. And John explains that for those who follow the Lamb wherever he goes, these have been redeemed from mankind as first fruits for God. They're singing a new song because they've experienced victory. The battle's done. It's time to sing and celebrate. Redemption was at hand. The new creation was at hand. And, you know, one of my favorite spots in all of the Chronicles of Narnia, C.S. Lewis talks, he picks up this image on the power of song and victory over darkness by mirroring Genesis. In the magician's nephew, Diggory, who is there watching Narnia come to creation. Do you know how Aslan creates Narnia? By song. It's by song. Here's the description that Diggory sees. In the darkness, something was happening at last. A voice had begun to sing. It was far away. And Diggory found it hard to decide from what direction it was coming. Sometimes it seemed to come from all directions at once. Sometimes he almost thought it was coming out of the earth beneath them. Its lower notes were deep enough to be the voice of the earth itself. It was beyond comparison the most beautiful sound he had ever heard. It was so beautiful, he could barely stand it. The voice was suddenly joined by other voices, more voices than you could possibly count. They were in harmony with it, but far higher up the scale, cold, tingling, silvery voices. The second wonder was that the blackness overhead all at once was blazing with stars. The new stars, the new voices began at exactly the same time. And if you had heard it as Diggory heard it, you would have felt quite certain that it was the stars themselves singing, and that it was the first voice, the deep one, which had made them appear and made them sing. All the time the voice went on singing, the eastern sky changed from white to pink, from pink to gold. The voice rose and rose till all the air was shaking with it. And just as it swelled to the mightiest and most glorious sound it had yet produced, the sun rose. And it goes on. One day, when this is all done, this is gone, and we're standing before the Lord, I think we're going to look back, and we're going to be really overtaken by what praise and worship is and what it does. That our song today does just what we just read. It is a means by which we are participating in the dawn of the new creation when we employ our minds and our bodies and our hearts in worship in conjunction with the heavenly hosts. The Lord takes great pleasure with us. We're declaring victory together. The verse 4 says, again, He crowns the humble with victory. We're participating in this new creation, pushing away the darkness as the sun of righteousness rise over us in warmth and in light. The victory is at hand. Each time we see and cheer and sing. You know, it's just like in the middle of a football game when you know your team's going to win and you're just cheering and rejoicing in what you see unfolding. And I tell you, and I'm pretty sure I said this a year ago, when we sing and when we worship, the powers and principalities of darkness shudder. They shudder. Because it's the declaration that the Lord has won and they have lost. Ted, let me tell you about my favorite act of worship that I remember. In Boston, at Park Street, huge music program and amazing choir, amazing praise band. We had everything you could imagine or want. Every week you'd come in, you'd be moved by the Spirit just as we are here. We put $1 million in renovating our organ, so that when that instrument played, the sanctuary would shake. We took great pride in our worship. During the summers, I would go down to New Jersey and work at a camp down in New Jersey. Weekends we would have off. We would just choose a random church and go to. And one Sunday, we went to this little country church, a little inland from the shore. And we walked in, maybe 40 people, 50 people at the most. And very friendly. They sang hymns on a piano. The pastor's message was good. And then we got to the offering. And I just couldn't believe what was happening. This woman, 50s, 60s, not particularly well-dressed, her hair was a little unkempt, walks up carrying a xylophone. She sets it down, and she sits down before it. And she begins to play Amazing Grace on the xylophone. Not very well. Not like we just sang Amazing Grace a moment ago. Missing notes. But what was even more shocking was that she sang as she played the xylophone. Have you ever seen that? Me neither. And as she hit those high notes, every time she tried, they were flat. 4 verses. And when she was done, I was in tears, though I didn't share that with folks on either side of me. I kind of kept it to myself. And I could have cried, you know, I could have been moved that way because it was ridiculous. And it was not very good. And you could have just laughed at it. God, oh my gosh, I'm glad I don't have to sit through this every week. That's not why I was moved. I was moved because this woman gave everything she could in the very best way she could to honor God. It would have never happened at Park Street Church. It wasn't good enough. But God took great pleasure in that woman. And the demons shuddered because of that woman. I wonder what you make of worship. Imagine if we saw ourselves surrendering ourselves with the elders above before the throne of God with our minds and our bodies and our hearts. Oh, what a transformation would happen here as the new creation expands more and more. Let's pray. Lord, we pray that you would forgive us for making worship about ourselves, not about you. Forgive us when we are unwilling to give our bodies or our emotion or our minds to you. Lord, by your Spirit, we pray that you would empower us to understand you, empower us to do things that bring glory to you, and by your Spirit, you would move our heart to worship you. We pray in Jesus' name, amen.
When the music fades.
Led, I would like to invite you forward because we would like to pray for you. So please. And I'd also like to invite the elders of the church to come forward so we can pray for Letta and lay hands on her, which is an ancient tradition of blessing for the church.
Ask people to sit down.
And everyone else, please sit.
Lord and Heavenly Father, thank you for the ability to stand here and pray on behalf of the congregation and for Letta and for all of those that are here. Lord, we will be leaving the building today, but I pray that you help us to take the worship with us, to be cognizant of the fact that Jesus Christ is with us at all times and that we can be with him, to have worship in our hearts, also on our lips and in our actions. For those within our congregation who need you, Lord, I pray that you be with them and you help them and you heal them. Specifically, we call out Sharon Jacoby and her cancer, Matt Matthews and lymphoma. We continue to pray for Betsy Batten and Betsy Huber and for all of the unspoken spiritual and physical needs. Please, Lord, be with those people and heal them and help others to be a part of that healing process. Lord, I specifically call out our women's ministry, the ladies that are in that group, the important part that they play within the ministry itself and with the families that are represented here and in our community. Be with them and help that program to strengthen them. For our congregation meeting tonight, Lord, please help us to come together and focus on you, just as we have spoke about today. Be a part of our actions, our decisions, and even our finances. And Lord, specifically today, we want to pray for Letta and all that she does for us.
We thank you, Lord, for the truth of Scripture, where you invite, let everyone who has breath praise the Lord. We thank you, Lord, that you have gifted us, blessed us with Letta, to lead us to praise you. We thank you, Lord, that she has led us through voice, through her fingers, through all of her body, Lord, that we can come together as one body praising you. Lord, we pray that you would give her assurance that you are the God that was and is to come, that you are the good shepherd, that you have shepherded her, and you will continue to guide her forward. Thank you, Lord, for Letta. We ask that you would continue to bless her, help her to experience your presence in a new way, so that she may sing a new song for the good works that you will continue to do through her. Bless her, Lord Jesus. And Lord, we gather together with thanksgiving in our hearts, and we remember the prayer that you taught your disciples long ago, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Let us continue to praise the Lord. Let us stand again, singing hymn number 43, Great is thy faithfulness.
Thank you.
do want to invite you to prayer after the service. If there's a need upon your heart and you'd like prayer with someone, we would consider it a great privilege to pray for any concern that you might have. I invite you across the hall for refreshments and celebration of Letta and her ministry among us. Gives you an opportunity to interact with her one-on-one as well. And of course, we have the annual meeting tonight and hope, even if you didn't sign up, you show up and we'll make sure that barbecue from, who's it, JJ Smokin' Grill or something like that, just multiplies no matter how many people show up. Now receive the benediction to the one who is so faithful to us. Great is his faithfulness. From generation to generation, to our generation, to those who are here among us this day. To the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit be all glory and majesty and power and dominion evermore. He is your King. He is your Maker. He is your Provider. He is your Protector. Go knowing that peace. Amen.